Hello, and welcome to this week's Movie Math, where sure, the box office numbers weren't so sexy this weekend, but that doesn't mean important things weren't happening, like a couple of people's careers dying, or at least taking very bad hits. But Disney, of course, made the biggest and happiest headline. They're the happiest place on earth, not just the theme parks, but the studio executive offices. Or should I say they made the biggest splash, because Finding Dory swam into the $1 billion club. Many of you were very happy to see this news. I got a ton of tweets about it. Well, not a ton, but a ton, in correlation to it being a business headline, right? On Sunday afternoon, when the announcement was made that Finding Dory is now officially a $1 billion movie. And I'm sure Pixar was like, woohoo, still got it in your face, Disney Animation, because the competition between the two step siblings over the Disney studio has gotten pretty complicated. But anyway, this is just great news for Disney all around. While Disney Animation might be having a problem with their two different divisions, the studio is firing on all cylinders, because this means that there are $3 billion entries for 2016, and they're all Disney, right? Like, wow. You've got Captain America Civil War, Zootopia, and now Finding Dory. And right behind that, almost at a billion, so close, is The Jungle Book. So that means the four biggest movies of the year are Disney. That's stunning. And only twice in the past has this happened. And actually only to Disney has it happened, though. And that's when there's been more than $1 billion film in a year. It's from the same studio. No other studio has been able to have multiple billion-dollar entries by themselves. And that was in 2013 with Frozen and Iron Man 3, and then again in 2010 with Toy Story 3 and Alice in Wonderland. And we've talked before about how Disney has the most entries in the $1 billion club overall. And there could be more to come, because they still have Doctor Strange. I don't think that's going to make a billion, but Moana potentially could, and so could Star Wars Rogue One, if those reshoots did the trick. I'm very excited about Rogue One, and considering how much money The Force Awakens made, I think there is some chance that that could squeak in there, right? It would make just half of what The Force Awakens made and still qualify as a $1 billion club movie. Whoa! But also, is there any other competition that could, get in the way? That could disrupt Disney's monopoly on the $1 billion club films this year? Well, Warner Brothers' DCEU movies couldn't get in there, and I think both of them should have actually gotten in there. I think they would have had they had been better reviewed. Fantastic Beasts, not feeling it right now, but I think that the momentum is certainly picking up. Harry Potter films have joined the $1 billion club in the past. Not all the time, but they've joined, and so there's some potential there. But you know what I actually think is the strongest competitor to get in there and mess up Disney's straight flush? Sony's Passengers. I think there's a very good chance that could make $1 billion. I think the trailer is very strong. I think you've got two incredibly popular leads, and you've got a romance mixed with action. It really is Space Titanic. And that, of course, also made a lot of money. So Disney, very pleased. And I'm sure they're very pleased, because none of the bad movies this weekend were theirs either. There's nothing to be a buzzkill here. So let's talk about the movies that did open this weekend and how they really hurt a number of people's careers. So Emily Blunt killed another movie. I've labeled her box office poison before, and she's still wearing the sticker after this weekend. Girl on the Train, sure, was able to win the weekend, but only with 24.6. Now, before the final numbers came in, it looked like it was going to maybe do 27, which wasn't so bad, because at least it had a 7 in it, and you could say it was a solid 10 million behind Gone Girl, which opened with 37.5. Of course, there's been a ton of comparisons between the two films, much to the annoyance of Girl on the Train. But it couldn't even get just in the 10 million striking distance range. It's even less than that. So I think that's extremely disappointing. On a side note, I'm sure some people are like, well, Gone Girl had Ben Affleck, although wait until you see how The Accountant is predicted to do, so he apparently is not a guaranteed box office win. But then, of course, I think David Fincher was, I think that combo was really huge. And of course, that was a much better reviewed film. The buzz for it was much stronger. Interestingly enough, though, I believe Gone Girl had a B cinema score, and Girl on the Train has a B minus. So that with cinema scores, it has to do with the legs of a movie, how it will do over the course of its whole run. So Girl on the Train really not looking good. But, you know, it's always been problematic for Emily Blunt, right? Like, so there was the idea that maybe Edge of Tomorrow and Sicario would win over some fans for her. Although, hugely embarrassing, they're like, yeah, we'll make a Sicario sequel starring Benicio del Toro. And you're like, whoa, that's so bad. Although I would agree with that. Anyone, I think, who has seen Sicario is like, yeah, there's your star. You stuck him in a supporting role. Outside of that, though, she's had Huntsman Winter's War, Into the Woods, Looper, Five-Year Engagement, Salmon Fishing in the Yemen, that was a great movie, though, and The Adjustment Bureau. The list just goes on and on of films that have not done well starring Emily Blunt. So I think that as much as many of us would have liked to have seen her play Captain Marvel, I think that from a business perspective, it's a really bad choice, and Kevin Feige was correct. I mean, we'll say what you will about Brie Larson, and we've said it, although she's winning me over with her fan pictures on social media. But while she might not deliver, just as there are some questions, I think a BTT viewer very astutely said, these Oscar winners aren't proven at the box office just quite yet. You know, you've got Eddie Redmayne, Brie Larson as Captain Marvel, and of course, Alicia Vikander as the upcoming Lara Croft. But at least they're untested. There's no proof that they're not going to deliver yet. Whereas Emily Blunt has in black and white numbers that she is a real problem at the box office. But you know who this is interesting for? Lin-Manuel Miranda, because of course Emily Blunt's next film is Mary Poppins Returns. Hilarious title, because of course that's a very popular title in the comic book realm, so to apply it to the Mary Poppins character is very funny. But anyway, I think that this opens the door for Lin-Manuel Miranda to take over that movie. And take over it he might, because that guy killed on Saturday Night Live this weekend. Not only did he do a great job, but it was recognized. He trended on Twitter number one. You know, when Margot Robbie, I mean, even though the ratings for that were quite good, Margot Robbie herself never trended. SNL Lin-Manuel Miranda, they turned the L in SNL to the first letter in his name, trended not only all night, but into early Sunday morning. It's just absolutely incredible. I don't know what the ratings were, but I think that his fandom, the theater community, is just supporting him so strongly, and he plays to that. It's very, you know, he very much played to his audience, and he did a great job. It was a very good episode. But the support is there, and they're going to push him in social media, and Mary Poppins Returns, I think, could very much end up being Lin-Manuel Miranda's movie. So Emily Blunt, better watch it. She better be able to play defense and offense with that film. So then there's The Birth of a Nation. Oh, so bad. Such a disaster. Now, I'm going to paint a picture for you because the situation, I think, is in its death throes. You know, that's the death throes of not only the movie, but Nate Parker's career. Actually, in the Hollywood Reporter article that we're going to discuss, the actual quote was, I don't think any of the projects that he's associated with are going to move forward. I'll put a link down below in the video description to this article because everyone should read it. So going into the weekend, the expectations were 7 to 10 million. They were like, it's probably going to do 7 to 8, but maybe it'll do 10. And then it did, of course, the lowest it could possibly do, 7.1 million. And also, this is really an unfortunate situation because Queen of Katwe, which has no controversy to surround it, also is doing very poorly. It's in its third week of release, a second weekend wide. Sorry, only at number 10. It's just absolutely a disaster. It's made 5.3 million total. Yikes. Whereas other, you know, quote unquote black films that are more mainstream, a little more commercial, they do in the teens and in the 20s with their opening, sometimes even more. So the audience is there, even if it was just to rely on the black community. The audience is there for bigger numbers, and they're just simply not showing up for Queen of Katwe or The Birth of a Nation. I don't know why they didn't show up for Queen of Katwe. Great movie. I think that I've seen some of you say that the problem with The Birth of a Nation is not only the scandal, which we'll talk about in a moment, but the slavery issue, that people in the black community, understandably, are just sick and tired of slavery movies and being depicted, like, really just saying, you know, we've done more than be slaves. And that's why I think movies like Hidden Figures and Fences are in a very good position. Now, as for the scandal, The Hollywood Reporter ran an article on Friday that I found quite shocking, and that's the one I've linked down below. And it was basically the beginning of spin control from Fox Searchlight for what's happening with this movie, because they paid a record-breaking number to release it, $17.5 million. They won the bidding war at Sundance. Oh, what a fateful day that ended up being. So I think they don't want to get blamed for this. They're like, yeah, you know, we don't want this to affect our negotiations going forward at other film festivals and acquiring other movies, with people being like, yeah, I saw how Birth of a Nation turned out. Get away from me, Fox Searchlight. Maybe I should go with Netflix. Because, you know, the competition to snap up these awards movies is very strong. And it was announced that Netflix made a deal, by the way, with iPic Theaters to a very small theater chain, which has like under 20 theaters in the United States, and it's not part of the NATO, the National Association of Theater Owners, such a funny acronym. But they can make this deal without getting in trouble with NATO that doesn't like this situation, but they're gonna release Netflix movies day and date theatrically so they can qualify for awards runs. But anyway, they had this Hollywood Reporter article, and they said, you know, we tried to help Nate Parker, and he just wouldn't let us. We had Oprah. When you hear that Oprah Winfrey wanted to do a special early on to tackle this problem with Nate Parker, and he said no, it just defies common sense, right? And I think that Nate Parker really was just, I think he was so against the idea of this being associated with this in any way that he made a lot of mistakes. Because he also insisted the movie open wide. That was part of the deal that he made with Fox Searchlight in order to go with them. And I think that really hurt the movie as well, because you get a crappy number like this, and if it had opened in a small release, like maybe 4 theaters, maybe he had a chance of having a high per theater average, and that would have been a much better headline than the one he's stuck with now. So the Hollywood Reporter had like sources inside Fox Searchlight say, you know, Oprah tried to help him, we gave him talking points, and he said he was going to go along with it, but then every time the cameras turned on, he just, you know, just jumped ship and, you know, followed his own script, and it was just, there was no helping the guy. It's a disaster. And we're throwing our awards muscle behind Jackie with Natalie Portman. That was basically the whole point of the article, I think, to really just say we're distancing ourselves from this movie. They had another article today in the Hollywood Reporter that they had the first Academy screening. We talked about this before with awards campaigns. Academy voters can go and see these movies for free. So they had the first Academy screening, so you could see The Birth of a Nation if you're an Academy voter. And they said it was only half full. And that's, you know, you can bring plus ones. So they said they said it was a 1,000-person theater, and with only about 500 people in there, that probably meant maybe 250 were actual voters. So that's extremely low turnout. Now, this also brings me to size of the theater. Someone over the weekend tweeted me and said, I'm very disappointed to see The Birth of a Nation is playing in a very small theater in my multiplex. And I asked them, you know, this guy said, I asked the theater manager why it was in such a small theater. And they said, well, we didn't think it was going to do particularly well. So, you know, and that's what theaters do. They pick the size of the theater based on what they think the demand will be, because they want to sell the most seats possible. And so they want, you know, it's the law of supply and demand, business 101. And I think that in this theater's defense, the picture that was tweeted to me wasn't a full theater anyway. So it's not like people were turned away from the smaller theater. Yes, it would be great if it was playing in a bigger theater, but blame Nate Parker and how he didn't stick to the talking points. I mean, that were provided to him. I mean, I can understand it's frustrating to him, but he should have, you know, I think, no matter what you might think of Fox Searchlight, you trust Oprah. I mean, I don't think she has the pull maybe that she once did, but she still has some pull, especially, I think, on a topic like this. I do think, though, that Denzel Washington and Viola Davis's Fences, also not a really strong commercial film, but I'll be curious to see, because of Denzel and because of Viola Davis and her increased footprint, not only with How to Get Away with Murder, but now Suicide Squad, if Fences can open bigger. Because Queen of Katwe, now The Birth of a Nation, let's see what happens with Fences at the box office, if it can get some better numbers. But I'm curious to hear your thoughts on this, but I do think that this situation's pretty much over. All right, so then the other new release for the weekend was Middle School, The Worst Years of My Life, and this is, you know, the worst years of Lionsgate's, professional life these days, because they're really struggling at the box office. Power Rangers, of course, was a ray of light over the weekend at New York Comic Con. But Middle School opened with $6.9 million, single digits. And interestingly enough, the Wimpy Kid movies, this is why it's a franchise, you know, I don't think that they do a good job letting this be known, but if you actually look at the numbers, they open in the teens. So it can be done. Also, Alexander and the Terrible, Horrible, No Good, Very Bad Day also opened in the teens. Ridiculous. I actually think, as you can see, one of those Wimpy Kids movies was in the 20s. So I think that the real problem here, though, was really non-existent advertising from Lionsgate. And Lionsgate continues to choke online discussion of their films. They were extremely aggressive over the weekend, claiming the trailers that were released at New York Comic Con, and they really shut down discussion because of it. I was going to do a John Wick shot by shot, but I decided ultimately against it because Lionsgate is just by far and away the most aggressive studio, as I've said before, out there when it comes to claims, and I think they're just shooting themselves in the foot. And they're going to, if they continue, I thought they were going to stop it after Hunger Games, and also they got a new head of the company, but they just keep doing it. And they did it to Hunger Games. They just took all the oxygen out of the room when it comes to fans, and that fire went down, right? And I really wonder what's going to happen to Power Rangers if that's really what their strategy is going to be, if they shut down discussion. Basically, what happened with Hunger Games, as I've discussed before, is if you had any discussion of Hunger Games whatsoever, they claimed the video. Even if it was a news piece and a commentary, they just claim everything. And I'm concerned about seeing that emerge again. It seemed like it had passed, but now I'm not so sure. So it's crazy. All right, then as for the rest of the top 10, Miss Peregrine and Deepwater Horizon dropped around 40 in the 40th percentile. Peregrine had a bigger drop, but it also had a bigger opening. And Magnificent Seven also dropped in the same area. And Storks, it held a little bit better, but not much. But still, at the end of the day, with all four of those movies, you don't have any hits here, especially considering the ridiculous budgets of three of the four. Peregrine's overseas numbers are, you know, kind of impressive, but still, you know, breaking even, I think, at this point is that movie's goal, and that's not the way it should have been. Sully, though, that's the big hit in the top 10 right now. It's the only one to pass the century mark, and it actually has $167 million worldwide, considering how country-specific that story is. The fact that it's playing so well overseas at all, I think is really impressive. And it's a good gold star for Tom Hanks, right? But we'll see. He might be hit very hard by Inferno at the end of the month. That could be something that goes, nobody still likes you as Robert Langdon. One of some of the worst casting I think they've ever done. I just don't think that, be self-aware, stars. Sometimes, it's, again, that quote, in the right role, I'm priceless. And it does seem that Robert Langdon is not the right role. Then as for the coming weekend, here's the shocker. The Accountant is expected to lead, but with only $17 million. What? That's ridiculous. Where's the DCEU bump, man? Ben Affleck, really very wildly popular as Batman, but only a $17 million opening is expected. Then Kevin Hart, $13.5 million. Which is, not great for Kevin Hart overall, but for his comedy concert movies, that would actually be a new high. So that's nice. And then Max Steel, obviously that's horrible. And Mattel is like, we're getting there. We're getting the hang of it. Cut us some slack. So, obviously they would like to see Barbie and Hot Wheels do much better. So that's the weekend box office. I'm curious to hear your thoughts on it. As I said, a lot going on there. So let's talk about it down below in the comments. And you can check out some more videos right now. We'll be right back.